Tonight, the story I'm going to read details the frightening insanity of a man who's lost his mind. Demonic possession or schizophrenia? You decide. Lock your windows, lock your doors, and enter the alternate nightmare. I was 19 at the time, now almost 26. My boyfriend and I lived together here in Wyoming, where I'm from, but he is not from here. This must have been Thanksgiving in 2013 or 2014. My boyfriend wanted to go home south to be with his family for a holiday. I was a little upset he wouldn't be spending the holiday with me, but knew he hadn't been home in a while. So I was happy he would be able to be with his family. He planned on staying for only about a week. But spoiler alert, he never came back. Once he got there, I just had a feeling of constant dread and sadness. He barely called, would scarcely text, and had cheated in the past. My thoughts were constantly consumed with who he was spending his time with. Anyway, that's slightly irrelevant. A couple of months go by. He's still there. Then one morning, I got a call from his mom. It surprised me as I had only spoken with her two times before when he and I lived together. However, I knew if she was calling me, it couldn't be good news. It wasn't, but it was at the same time. She called to tell me that he had gotten in with the wrong crowd and had been doing some pretty serious drugs. He had a complete meltdown, and something had happened with the group of friends that led to him being targeted. She didn't go into too much detail about that. She then said that she sent him to live with a relative up north. So that was the bad news. The good news was that she told me how he was so upset because he promised me we'd be together for Valentine's Day, which, at this point, was a little less than a month away. So she explained to me how she'd offer to pay for half of my plane ticket to see him so we could spend it together. However, he kept urging me that I should wait and that he wasn't himself. I didn't care. How bad could he be? Fast forward a couple of weeks, and I'm boarding my plane to fly to the northeast part of the United States, where I had never been before. But, again, I felt on top of the world. Not only would I finally be seeing my boyfriend for the first time since Thanksgiving, but I had never been to that part of the country before. And experiencing it for the first time with him made me feel like this would be one of the best times of my life. But, man, was I wrong. Immediately upon arriving in the hotel he was staying at, I got a bad feeling in my stomach, which only got worse when he opened the door. I could tell he wasn't him the moment he opened that door. He was excited to see me, but didn't give me the welcome I had all imagined. Instead, he hugged me, kissed my forehead, said he was glad I was there, then just quietly and slowly walked back to the bed and laid down. He seemed so, blah, sad, just not his usual goofy giddy self. Now I knew his mom told me something had happened to him, so I correlated his behavior with how anyone would be if something traumatic had happened to them. Anyone who knows me knows I'm not the best at comforting people. It's just not my thing and always makes me feel awkward. I always just assume there's absolutely nothing I could say or do to make someone feel better when they're down like that. But I would try my hardest to bring him back to who he was and be there for him. I laid down and cuddled up to him. I told him he could say to me about it if he wanted to, but if not, I wouldn't push it. So we laid there and cuddled and had small talk, mostly about my trip there and our puppy that I had bought him for Christmas. It was then that he'd start interrupting me. But not to chime in about what I was telling him, but talking to someone in the corner of our hotel room, which it was just us. I don't even remember what he'd say, but it'd be the most random thing that didn't pertain to my topic at all. I'd lift my head off his chest, huh? And he'd just chuckle and say, aha, nothing. So at this point, I was pretty confused and apprehensive about him. All I could think about was his mom urging me to wait. This happened about two or three times before I finally said, well, are you hungry? I'm starving. He said sure, and that there was a restaurant just right across the street from our hotel. We get to the restaurant and sit down. I order, and he tells the waiter he's not hungry. My food comes, and as I'm eating, he apologized for being so blah. He told me how happy he is that I'm there and told me he'd take me to get my nails done tomorrow and do something fun. He was a little better at dinner, so that made me feel much more at ease. We walk back to our hotel. It's almost 10 p.m. now, so I wasn't mad when he suggested putting on a movie and relaxing. As we were lying there, I started to kiss him and be a little touchy. I hadn't seen my man in almost 3 months. Can you blame me? That was when he grabbed my hand and told me no. that he had decided he didn't want to do that again until marriage. That was odd to me because we had a very healthy sexual relationship before. I thought he was kidding, so I laughed and tried to proceed. He grabbed my hand again and said he was serious. I was a little irritated, because I wanted to show him how much I missed him. But I stopped, and we started engaging in small talk again, which is when he proposed to me. But not like offered. He asked me if I'd marry him, but he didn't get on one knee and didn't have a ring or anything. But he was earnest too. This excited me. I said yes. We decided on going to a jewelry store in the morning to pick out a ring. He then got up and got his notebook out of his bag, and we spent the next hour or so writing down wedding plans before falling asleep. All right. I'm getting to the point of the story that you're all here for. I promise much more happens than him just talking to himself. I woke up the following day feeling like the luckiest girl in the world. I looked over at my man and just got butterflies. Does this man want to spend the rest of his life with me? I kissed him, and he woke up. We snuggled a bit and decided to get up and get some breakfast. I thought and hoped maybe today he'd be back to himself. At first, he seemed a lot better. Still not the same, but better. We went to the local Denny's and got some breakfast, then went over to the mall. This is where it started going downhill more. We're walking in the mall hand in hand, smiling and pointing at things and windows at stores, where he then starts talking to himself again. At first, I say, "What?" But then, after looking up at him, notice he wasn't looking at me just right in front of him. Didn't even acknowledge that I had asked, "What?" I say he was talking to himself because he wasn't talking to me or anyone else. But it was like he was having a straight-up conversation with someone. Again, I can't quite remember everything he was saying, but I do remember him just laughing and replying, "Ah, yeah. I know, right? It's wild." Or no, trust me, we won't do that, just things like that. I let this go on for at least a complete circle around the whole mall. I was just pretending to look at store windows while my mind was racing, wondering not only what the hell was going on, but what to do, what to say. We were walking upon a K jeweler's, so I figured this was my time to say something. I interrupted his conversation with, "Well, should we look at rings?" Making a head gesture towards the jewelry store. He snapped out of it, looked over at the store, smiled, and said yes. We picked out a ring. I got the credit application, and it was almost a done deal when he stopped and asked if we could take the night to think about it. I agreed. It was a big decision to make. We hadn't even told our friends and family yet. And then, in the back of my head, I'm thinking, and it's clear you're not in your right headspace. We get back to the room. He told me he was going to take a shower and asked if I'd join him. This surprised me and excited me at the same time since the previous night when I was being touchy. He stopped me. So I smiled and said, "Of course." This ended up being the most awkward shower I'm sure I will ever take in my life. But he's behind me, putting soap on my back, and I could feel that he was enjoying the shower, if you know what I mean. So this gave me a little hope that maybe he'd disregard the celibacy thing he mentioned the previous night. Wrong. Just as I was about to reach behind me and start touching him, I stopped right as he said, "I know she's gorgeous, right?" And he starts conversing with himself again. So I say it was an awkward shower because it consisted of him talking to someone else about me. They were talking about my body, in depth, and how beautiful I was. So I'm just standing there wondering if I should be saying thank you. I mean, technically, they're compliments, but on the other hand, he's talking about it as if I wasn't right there. I don't even remember if I ever said anything. I think I just stared at the wall and avoided eye contact with him since every time I'd look at him, he'd be wholly engaged with something else in the corner of the shower. Then out of my peripheral, I'd see him look at parts of my body, and the weird compliment conversation would start up again. The shower finally ended. I felt sad. All I wanted to do was cry and go to sleep. But this is where things took a much deeper turn, the part of this whole trip that I'll never be able to explain. We're both lying in bed, naked. He's still talking to himself or whoever the hell he's talking to. When out of nowhere, he jumped out of bed so fast it startled me, almost as if something had bitten him or something. Before I can even get the "what's wrong" out of my mouth, he screams at me, "Are you the devil?" I just looked at him with wide eyes, not even knowing what to say. Before I could even say anything, again, "Are you the fucking devil?" I am freaking the fuck out at this point. On the inside, On the outside, I do nothing but stare. So I just say as calmly as I can. Though, why would you think that? Stop lying to me, devil. Do you think you're fooling me? I will not let you do this. I lay there, and tears begin to fill my eyes. I just watched as he started grabbing any loose object he could find in the room and setting them on top of me in the bed. Like he was trying to hold me down or something. I mean, he grabbed pens, notebooks, both our luggage, clothes, even the phone, and a nightstand. Just on top of me in the bed, all while he's still screaming and asking if I'm the devil and who sent me. At some point during all of this, I discreetly grabbed my phone and called his mom. I didn't put it up to my ear. I just wanted her to hear what was going on. I could listen to her freaking out, praying, saying she'd call her brother. I'm just laying there, with all these objects on me, tears streaming down my face, hoping this was a bad dream. I didn't think it could get worse, but it did. He then got a cup of water from the bathroom. When he came back, I shit you not, he started performing an exorcism on me. I've never seen an actual exorcism, but I've seen plenty of horror movies. This man started speaking another language and throwing water on me, and putting a cross up to my forehead. Then, he'd violently grab my arms and ask why the water wasn't burning my skin. I'd scream every time he'd come close to examine my body for burns from the water. I was so terrified I didn't know what would be coming next. I'd never seen eyes so black in my life. I couldn't even see the whites of his eyes, and they were completely black. Apart from his black eyes, the scariest thing in the whole situation was him speaking another language. I knew he didn't know any other languages, and whatever he was saying, Latin maybe, he was telling it as if it was his first language. I thought for sure someone in this hotel had called the front desk by now. I hadn't screamed at the top of my lungs, but loud enough to where people staying at least 2 to 3 rooms down would have heard. Finally, there is a knock at the door. Thank fuck. The amount of relief I felt in my body is unexplainable. He stops the exorcism right away. Looking over at the door, I got a little scared again as he yells, "Who did you send?" But then we hear, "Cameron," and it's me. "Uncle Mike," he says calmly. I changed the names just in case, you know. He walks over to the door calmly, opens the door, and thank God his uncle is finally here. His mom had told me she was calling him, but it felt like hours since I'd heard her say that. I almost thought I heard wrong. He invites his uncle into the room and, once walking far enough to see the bed on the other side of the bathroom wall, has a look that I can only explain as mortified. He and I make eye contact and just stare at each other for probably a good 10 seconds. He walks over to the bed and starts taking off all random objects. The first nightstand. Cameron tries to stop him, explaining that I'm the devil and he's not done saving his fiance yet. His uncle says something random along the lines of, "I know, but what needs to be done cannot be done here. We need to change locations." Cameron surprisingly agrees and lets his uncle continue taking all the objects off of him. Once I only had the blankets left on me, drenched in certain spots from the water thrown at me but soaked from my hands grasping a particular place. His uncle says, "Go ahead and put some clothes on." Even though I had blankets on me, it was clear I at least wasn't wearing a shirt. My shoulders and arms had been exposed the whole time, and my hair was in a bun. I slowly got up and grabbed clothes. Uncle Mike walked away and led Cameron further to the other side of the room by the window. It was utterly silent. Usually, I'd feel uncomfortable because I was naked. I had never met Cameron's uncle before in my life. But the feeling of relief was so strong that the feeling of being uncomfortable or awkward was not present at the time. I remember grabbing a hoodie and sweatpants. As I put my shoes on, his uncle said, "Go out to the parking lot and wait in the red truck. We'll be out shortly." As I'm about to walk out the door, I hear, "Uncle Mike, we can't let her leave." "That's not her. It's the devil." I get to the lobby, walk by the front desk, where I'm happily greeted by the man working behind it. He had no idea. Our room was on the first floor. Immediately upon taking a right past, the front desk is the hallway where the rooms start. We were maybe 6 rooms down, and he had no idea. I walked out the main doors. I didn't even smile back at the employee, just stared at him as I kept walking. The red truck stuck out like a sore thumb. As I think about and picture this, it's almost like it was the only truck in the parking lot. I get in the passenger side, freezing. I hadn't grabbed my coat, and it's February in the northern United States. I call his mom, who had reached at least 10 times. She answers after the first ring. I sob as I tell her what happened. His uncle's truck wasn't parked right in front of the automatic double doors like you would if you were booking a room, but right on the other side where if I were to turn the headlights on, the headlights would shine right through the front doors and into the lobby. To the right of the doors, I barely see the employee at the front desk. I continue telling his mom about what happened when I see Cameron running into the lobby, his uncle right behind him. They startle the man behind the front desk. I can see Cameron is upset and yelling, his uncle with a worried look on his face making the known hand gesture of calm down. And the employee now on the phone. I knew he was calling the cops. This worries his mom and me because, well, Cameron is an African American. This was right before the Black Lives Matter movement. Within what seems like seconds, I see cherries and berries. Lots. About four cop cars pull up to the entrance right as I see Cameron throw a little end table that had been next to one of the lobby couches. I got out of the truck to see better because one of the cop cars was now blocking my view, just in time to see him swing at one of the officers and book it down the hall. I then see the side door of the hotel swing open and Cameron taking the fuck off. He ran right by me, didn't even look at me. One officer takes off on foot behind him while the rest get in their vehicles. His uncle walks out the automatic doors while I'm looking in the direction my fiancé ran. He hugs me and tells me to get in the truck. I don't remember what we talked about, if we even talked at all. But he got word that Cameron had been detained and was taken to the hospital. We drove there, but by the time we arrived, Cameron had been sedated. His uncle took me to breakfast. It was around 4 a.m. at this point, to Denny's, where just a little less than 24 hours before Cameron and I were holding hands talking about the wedding. His uncle explained to me how that wasn't his nephew. He'd never seen him like that. I told him everything that happened, thanked him for showing up, and he took me back to the hotel. It was officially Valentine's Day now, and I had to go back to that room by myself. His uncle offered his home to me, but I declined. I wanted to be alone as much as I didn't want to be alone. But I wanted Cameron, a Cameron I fell in love with. I walked back into the room that was completely trashed, and just laid there for a few hours reliving everything that had gone down just a few hours prior. Finally, around 7 a.m. I called a cab to the hospital, but Cameron was no longer there and was in jail. So I went back to the room where I spent the next 3 days alone, crying. I arrived back in Wyoming to my best friend, roommate, excited to hear all about my trip. Upon seeing my face, she knew something had happened. We sat there on the couch, and I just laid into her, and she held me while I cried and told her everything that had happened. A week later, Cameron called me. I had kept in contact with his mom, who had been trying to get him out of jail since I left. I was so excited to see his name pop up on my phone. I couldn't wait to talk to him. He called to break up with me. I was still going to marry him even after all of that. I was devastated. You know that scene in one of the Twilight movies when Edward breaks up with Bella, and she's a complete zombie and depressed for months? That was exactly me. Almost 7 years later, I still have not seen Cameron. He never came back to Wyoming. The last time I saw him was when he flew by me running from the cops. We talk now and then. We just checked on each other recently because of this pandemic. We've not discussed what happened at all, ever. According to his mom, who I haven't spoken to since about a month after the incident, he doesn't remember anything. I asked if I'd not tell him, so I haven't. I recently told the story to a friend after saying my ex-fiancé in a conversation, and they had no idea I was ever engaged. So lately, I've had this burning urge to ask Cameron about it. I'm dying to hear his side. I found this podcast on YouTube a few weeks back and thought some might enjoy my story. I think Cameron was possessed. His mom always blamed it on drugs, but I don't know of any medicines ever making someone fluent in another language. So what do you guys think? If tonight's story scared you, be sure to hit that like button, and don't forget to subscribe for more terrifying stories.